This morning's scripture was already read, but I do just want to re-emphasize a couple of verses. So we are still in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, but verses 24b, 26 is what I want to emphasize. But God has put the body together, giving great honor to the parts that lacked, so that there should be no division in the body, but that its parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices in it. My title this morning is, Are You in Your Place?
Are you in your place?
For me, it has been a challenge to work in my gift. I have had a lot of Jonah experience, attempts to hide and to run and to deny where and what I'm supposed to do. But I've come to realize that that not only is doing a disservice to myself, I'm doing a disservice to the people that my life, that I'm supposed to touch through my life. And so I'm not fulfilling God's purpose, because God uses us to help one another. God speaks to each of us to help one another. Mm-hmm. Because although you can hear God in your own prayer time, we as individuals need something tangible. So if God speaks and says something to me and tells me to tell it to someone or preach in the sense, it is a disservice for me not to do so, because that is part of my calling. And I've run from this particular part of my calling for a long time. So I guess I just got so tired. And God said, you tired enough now? You gonna do what I told you to do? Yes, sir. So what I'd like to talk about briefly is encouraging us to be in our place. The body, the description of the body that we all know, each and every one of us has the male gender, female gender. We have all the same parts, but we're all different. We're all made up different. We're our color, our height, our weight, our size, our complexion. We're all made different, but we all have the same general parts. But in the body of Christ, we are responsible to stand in whatever part God has called you to. And when we don't do that, we leave a gaping hole for the enemy to fill.
Amen.
So if my words are supposed to comfort you, edify you, lift you up, pick you up, help you heal, and I don't do that, then I leave me. If my responsibility is to say something to you to help you heal something, and I don't, then I leave you susceptible to the enemy. Mm-hmm. That's something that's responsibility that we don't realize that most of the time. Mm-hmm. Our responsibility is not just God's. It's our responsibility to take care of one another.
Amen.
So like the scripture said, if there is an area of lack, he's going to pay more attention to that and to help that area. But those that are in abundance, everybody can praise together. But when you are in lack, you need help.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So although you may not know it, you are all equipped already to do what it is God's called you to do. Because he wouldn't call you to do something if he has not prepared you for it.
Mm-hmm.
Or at least given you the tools that you can start preparing yourself while you hear and get direction from him. Mm-hmm. We often blame other people. Or the pastor didn't tell me. Well, and pastor has told our group often, we have to be very mindful when we are in this position, because there are some people that do not hear or read anything from the Bible in the Bible except on Sunday mornings.
Mm-hmm.
So when we speak, when we're reading from the Bible or we're talking about things of the Bible, we have to be very clear and concise with our words, because this may be the only time.
Mm-hmm.
When I went to New York a few weeks ago, the preacher that spoke on Friday night said something very interesting. They were transitioning between the praise and worship and the night service. And after praise and worship, people sat down and got everything situated. He said, now I'm getting ready to start service. And so everybody should be settled. I don't want to hear no candy wrappers. I don't want to hear no water bottles crinkling. I don't want to hear any of that. Because you don't know if the person sitting next to you has received anything from God recently. And this may be the only time that they come to church for a year or whatever, 6 months, whatever it may be. And you may hinder them.
Amen.
Because they can't hear over your snacks.
Distraction.
Amen.
Amen.
You understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
We don't realize that. So, my point is to encourage you to stand in your place confidently. Be who God has called you to be confidently. I have something that I wanted to do. I know Pastor's not going to want to do it because he doesn't feel good. Let me do it real quick. Acolyte, stand up. So Dion is a crucifer today. So Dion, come here. Dion is our pastor. Dion is our pastor. Dion is the head of this house. Amen?
Amen.
Josh, come on. Josh is his right hand. Now his right hand can be rub it Charles.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm here today. Ed could be, that could be his right hand, or it could be me.
Pastor.
All right? We have different roles, but it could be either one of us. Come here. Sadea is on this, right hand. Okay.
Stage.
That would be Mr. Lawrence, who is the trustee. So these two right here, these two positions, without them being filled with people that are proactive and know how to handle their job and or resolve an issue if it comes up, you understand what I'm saying? Then he can sleep at night, one, but he can walk in his calling, which is to pray and to preach.
Mm-hmm.
Understand?
Yes.
So all these fires, these little fires that pop up and situations that go on, he can't handle all of that, and he's not supposed to.
Mm-hmm.
So these two positions stand beside him to make sure that he's covered and that things are working fine. Casey is Crystal. Casey is the stewardess board president. They take care of the pastor. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
She's in her place. Then again, he can sleep at night. He can pay his rent. He can do whatever it is that he needs to do. They have nice parties for his birthday and anniversary. And
they feed him.
They feed him, even though he lies and says they don't. They feed him. And very nice to him and his family.
Alex.
And you are, let's see, you'd be the missionary president.
Oh.
So you just stand next to her. Okay. So this is a skeleton example. But my point is that without his right or his left hand, he's lacking.
Mm-hmm.
If he is right-handed and his right hand is not available, he's injured or whatever it may be, then he's gonna have a deficiency. But if his right hand is in place, and able-bodied, then he can do what he needs to do and not worry about the things that the right hand should be taking care of, which would be the stewards. You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
He can trust the steward board president to go in the room as they count the money, and he doesn't have to worry about somebody cutting in on it and you know, skimming off the top. You understand what I'm saying? Like that, he can trust that man to do that job. Or if it's me, he can yell at me for whatever it is I've done or not done, and he just wants to yell. I get it. I get yelled at all the time. I'm fine. He's been around long enough that I'm now like a duck. Just rolls off my back. And I do, if something I need to correct, I do it. But if it's just him in the bad mood, it's okay. We're good. But my point is that just like God is speaking about the body, the foot can't tell the hand, you're not part of the body. Yes, everyone sitting in here has a place in the body of Christ. Your position or your duties in a certain area may change, but you still, as long as you are a Christian, you have some responsibility in the body of Christ. Because we're all called to do different things. These missionaries or the deaconess happen to, most of them are playing both roles, but they're called, first Sunday, communion Sunday, whatever it is, they know what they're supposed to do. Nobody has to tell them. And that also allows him to sleep. because he knows that they're going to handle their business. Sometimes we don't understand that when you know what you're supposed to do, we tell our kids this, but sometimes adults still do it. You know what you're supposed to do, and you wait on somebody to tell you what you're supposed to do. Ain't that aggravating? Right? You know what you're supposed to do. Just do it. And it's bad enough that we have to tell our kids over and over, but you got to come to a household of faith with a whole bunch of grown-ups and still do the same thing. Y'all just don't know. There are plenty of situations where people just don't do what they're supposed to do and wait for somebody to tell them. And that does not help. That causes a dysfunction. Because then he gets frustrated because he's got to deal with a fire. Because there are also sometimes when people don't want to talk to nobody but the pastor, even though other people can help you resolve the issue. But they don't want to talk to nobody but him. But that's not, we must mature. We must mature in our faith. We must mature and we must be willing to resolve issues and to grow and to move past things. Is that happening with you, Mike? Every time I say something, it's squeaks. You know, we've got to mature. We've got to mature. Thank you, guys. You can sit down. Give me my hand. So, my point, y'all know that I don't stand up here long. But I really want you to understand, and in my prayer time the last couple of days, God's just over and over and over and over, just tell them that they are prepared. You are endowed with the gift. Some of you have started to use it and got a little nervous and you stopped. Some of you have it and just try to ignore that it's there, but it doesn't go anywhere. And some don't understand what to do with it. And that's fine. Truthfully, all of those things are really okay because we've all been there. We've all been in those places. Because you don't want to be out there in front of a crowd if you're scared to speak publicly, right? So go to someone who can help you or encourage you on what things you can do and what things will help you utilize that gift. Because somebody needs to hear it. Somebody needs to hear it. And when he's not feeling well, we have to be able to be in our place without a thought. And we have to know if he's not here, service needs to run. And because I've gotten in trouble enough, y'all gonna get started at 11 o'clock. Mm-hmm. Somewhere he got a spy up in here, and when we don't, I hear about it later.
It's Lisa.
Yes. Somebody. But that has helped me grow so much in my own giftings. It helped me develop. He's helped me develop even in the funny conversations we have, but also in the stern conversations. I want you to correct me if I'm not doing something right. That's me. Don't just watch me continue to do something wrong and you know it's wrong. Tell me.
Amen.
Because that's not doing, it ain't doing nothing for nobody.
That's right.
So that, but that is us trying to mature, and that's what God wants from us. He wants us to want more of Him. The more of Him that we are given, the Holy Spirit, as the Holy Spirit falls upon us and develops and grows and stretches us, and we go to another level in Him, it's something that's undeniable, but it's scary sometimes. So we have to learn how to get past the fear of it. The fear of, oh God, what is this you're calling me to do now? This is bigger than the last thing. I don't know if I can handle it. But you can. You can. Because He wouldn't take you somewhere or lead you somewhere and leave you alone. Right?
Amen.
So, God has designed you to be what you are and who you are. Some of us were a size 8. Some of us don't. Some of us don't. That doesn't mean there's anything wrong with us that don't. We just don't. But those kind of self-esteem things will keep you from working out your gift. Will keep you from blessing someone because you're worried about what they're going to think. You know what I figured out? God knew I was going to be this size before I got here.
Mm-hmm.
And my calling has not changed. He's like, yeah, and you put on pounds and still get up and do what I told you to do.
Amen.
And there's no excuse for me not to. Because the pounds ain't stopping my mouth from moving. Sometimes it stops me from standing so long, but my mouth is still moving. So, 1 Corinthians, this particular letter that Paul is writing to the church, it is to bring clarity and correction and the containment of the confusion, because they had so much confusion and they needed to be corrected. And since he could not be there physically, he wrote them. They were filled with the Holy Spirit, but the church was still divided. Some of the members became jealous of other members because of their gifts. I have enough on my own plate. I do not want what you got. Because that looks heavy and busy. So being jealous of someone else, that's if it's not you, if you don't have it, just work what you got. Just work what you got. Because God gave it to you for a reason. We get busy looking at other people and wanting and coveting what they have, marriages, gifts, whatever, cars, houses, whatever it is. Marriage is hard. And yes, I have a wonderful husband. He's very sweet. I love you, babe. But marriage is hard. And people tell us all the time how we make marriage look easy. We just don't fight a lot. But he still was on my nerves.
And you get on his.
And it's okay, because I get on his. But we ain't going nowhere. But it's the truth. Marriage is hard. Ministry is hard. Mason told Nevada the other day, they were at my house playing, and they were arguing over some toy. And Mason turned around and said, "There, I told you life was hard, so stop acting like you don't know." They five. Who you been? What grandpa? The old folks home, we've been sitting there listening to that. I didn't know where he got that from. But he told her, life is hard. Life is hard. Mm-hmm. It might say one of y'all, but I was helping you out. If he says it, you already know. He believes it. But God designed us all for the gifting that he gave us. We are designed by him. He knows every hair on our head, every eyelash
Amen.
That we have.
Amen.
Every pore on our bodies.
Yes.
He created us. So following him should be our service.
Amen.
That should be our humble service to the one who we came from.
Amen.
I'm going to stop right here, but I want you to understand that if you do not walk out or at least start to pay attention to and start to pray a little bit more about your gifts and where you're supposed to be and what you're supposed to do, you can make yourself physically sick.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that breaks my heart, that I've seen people live lives, their life as if that is not possible, but it is. You can get physically sick by not being in your place.
Mm-hmm.
And doing what he's called you to do. And if we have someone, if you have someone that you know has a calling that they're not walking out, talk to them. You may not be walking out yours either, but you can encourage someone else while you try to figure out yours. Encourage someone else. Because we don't want to watch our sisters and brothers die without them completing at least some form of what they're called to do. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I'm done.